Hey.
Yeah, that's us.
That's us.
We're back.
We're back. I'm back.
Freedom Forum is back on the 30th day of the 9th month, year of our Lord, Jesus the Christ, 2015. Let us pray. This prayer is for all of you out there as you fight for the future of your families, the state, and the nation. Passion of Christ, strengthen us. Strengthen us under the pressure of temptation. Strengthen us when principle is at stake. Strengthen us to do your will, dear Lord. Strengthen us in moments of suffering, in times of loneliness, in periods of depression. Strengthen us that we may never swerve from you, nor weaken through human respect, through a desire to be popular, or through hope of social distinction. Strengthen us to accept our cross and carry it generously to the end. On the battlefield of life, stand by us that we may never prove a traitor in the ranks. Stand by us that we may not be dazzled by the glitter and glow of the enemy camp. In Jesus the Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
As you can tell, Mr. Jim's back.
Yeah.
He had a hiatus. Oh, no, that was a leg hold.
A leg hold, yeah.
And Freedom Forum meeting tomorrow night, 6:30 at Elise's on Johnson Street, 6:30 to 9:30-ish. And you'll just have to come to find out what we're going to talk about. It will be interesting, though, and informative, and could save your life. And Jim will tell you about next Thursday, a week from tomorrow.
Yeah, I don't have my props and my teleprompter. Anyways, the Acadiana Patriots meeting is October the 8th, next Thursday, starting at 6 p.m. And we will have Brett Guyman, who's going to talk about budget reform and Common Core. And Brett has been in the battle against Common Core for as long as I can remember. And then we're going to have one of the candidates for Lieutenant Governor John Young is going to come and speak, and he'll do a Q&A after his talk, and then we'll have meet and greet afterwards. That's next Thursday. Should be a very interesting meeting, and it's 2 days before early voting.
Yep. And on that Saturday, the 10th, gun show here at the Lafayette Event Center on Johnson Street, 9 to 5 on Saturday, and on Sunday the 11th, 10 to 4 at Lafayette Event Center, 10th and 11th gun show here. And if things are true to form, this September, I didn't hear anything yet, for September just over now, but September should have been a pretty good month, except for school purchases for buying guns and ammo, since they had the tax-free day at the beginning of the month.
Mm-hmm.
All right. We're going to jump into the main news item all over the world today was the fact that the Russians have made a big splash in Syria. Well, what you don't know is there's some of the details they're leaving out. But we'll get to that in a minute. The interesting thing is that the establishment media, all of them including Fox, all of the C3M, the controlled codependent corporate media, has been pretty much spouting the same line over the last couple of days regarding Russia's presence in Syria. And I guarantee you, it's the same as the New York Times came out with a few days before that, because the New York Times guides the rest of them, even Fox. Don't kid yourself. Well, here's a more realistic appraisal of what's going on over there. This is dated today. Russia's the New Hegemon by James Lewis. Under Obama and the left, America has retreated from the world. We've abandoned our allies all the way from Japan and South Africa to Saudi Arabia and Israel. Stop. I forgot something. Sound check. They did some more tweaking on the sound equipment in here. If there's a problem with it, give us a holler. If there's no problem, don't worry about it. If the sound is still a problem, call in. Okay? They told us what they did, but being a computer Neanderthal and barely having graduated from Wheelbarrow, I don't know what he was talking about. So hopefully it works. Back to Russia is the new hegemon. Obama has supported the paleo-fascist Ikhwan Brotherhood in the Sunni Arab world and Iran in the Shiite half of Mohammedanism. China has snatched a major part of the South China Sea with its undersea mineral wealth. Russia is gradually pulling Europe back from the east. Pushing Europe back from the east. While Obama was distracting you with Mohammed the bomb-faking kid, Russia made a major anti-Iran, anti-Obama move in Syria, sending a reported 2,000 personnel to take over a large Syrian airbase in Latakia along with the naval port of Tartus. Putin is a strategic opportunist and his chess game is not hard to guess. We know he wants to exploit American weakness and betrayal of our allies to rebuild Russia as a superpower. Russia's big move into Syria is designed to accomplish several objectives. First, he's propping up Syrian President Assad. This seems to serve Iran's strategy of surrounding the Arab Sunnis and Israel in a Shiite crescent. But in fact, Putin has just sliced the Iranian crescent in half by interposing a blocking force. And I'm going to come back to this and explain some things that match this theory much better than what the imbeciles on Fox, etc., are claiming about this stuff. The history of Russia and Mohammedanism. In fact, again, Putin has just sliced the Iranian crescent in half. Assad will owe his survival to Uncle Pooty Poot, not the theocracy of Iran. Putin has an alliance of convenience with Tehran, but Russia has centuries of experience fighting Muslim enemies all the way to the end of the Ottoman Empire in World War I. Putin has battled Muslim rebels in Chechnya and does not need a rising nuclear caliphate next door, an hour's flight from Russia's borders. Actually, well, I'll come back to that too. Putin is nobody's friend. He's a Russian nationalist with a close domestic alliance with the Orthodox Church, just like the Tsars. In the Armageddon world Obama has allowed to rise, Putin is a rational player compared to the suiciders of Iran. As usual, Putin is playing a double game, helping to build Iranian nuclear power stations, each of which is also a big fat target. They're going to be easy for the Russians to take out. If they help them build them, they'll have the GPS coordinates built right into the missile that's assigned to blow them up.
Probably already plugged in.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Putin is taking money to sell Iran 100 long-distance air refueling planes designed to project military power far from Iranian bases. The trouble is those planes will put Russia well within the flight radius of Iran's new nuke bombs. So Putin just sliced Iran's pincer movement around Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and Israel. Move, counter move. Putin wants to claim to fight ISIS, excuse me. He may do so. It's good cover and would give Russia military clout in Iraq and parts of Syria. But he needs a bigger energy supply to maintain his political clout in Russia, to supply Russia with fuel, and to try to set up a second OPEC with Russia at the top, which, an aside there quickly, they're doing that with this currency, this international currency that they're developing, and it's just a matter of time before they, the Chinese, and a bunch of other countries start requiring that currency for their international trade. By rescuing the Saudis and Israel from Iranian aggression, Putin is piling up IOUs in the fast-changing world of energy politics. The world price of oil is collapsing with the spread of shale exploitation, and there's no way to stop it. China is becoming a shale producer in the South China Sea. Of course, this is the reason for their turning these shallow reefs into land, dry land islands, and they're building even more bases and ports and military facilities on these artificial islands they're now creating. Russia's new military position in Syria gives him clout in the jihad war near Turkey, now under Islamo-fascist Erdogan, blocking Iran, the Obama-favored regional hegemon, and as the new superpower protector of Saudi Arabia and the Gulf oil producers. And again, we're going to come back to this with what's just happened this week. Russia's Syrian bases are also pressuring the eastern Mediterranean with its new shale energy discoveries. The eastern flank of NATO and the Balkans under increasing threat from Iranian and Sunni subversion, i.e. all of these refugees that are being forced to migrate into non-Mohammedan areas of Europe. Western Europe keeps importing hostile Muslim populations from Pakistan, Africa, and the Middle East. The Germans just collapsed in the face of a phony invasion by thousands of refugees, many men of military age who did not bother to hide their hatred for their new welfare hosts. Europe's flabbiness is an open invitation to aggressors, both Russia and Islam, and Russia seems more rational. Muslim infiltration and power buying in Europe goes back to the rise of OPEC in the 70s. The French have a long history of allying with Russia against Germany, and today they seem to be rebuilding that alliance to keep 50 million militant Muslims in check. Only Russia has the will and a military capacity to resist jihad by infiltration. France just launched a bombing raid against ISIS training camps, which happened to coincide with Putin's troop movements into Syria. Coincidence?
No way.
Which also claims to be a move against ISIS. Our former allies, Egypt, Israel, and Saudi Arabia, having been backstabbed by Obama, are not saying a word against the Russian move into Syria. In fact, there's indicators that they are all in favor of it. Again, coming back to that. They may not trust Putin, but they can make deals with him. They know what he wants. Saudi Arabia can offer oil and price coordination with Russia and help to control the Chechen rebels. Israel can utilize its new shale discoveries in the eastern Mediterranean and is a valuable source of badly needed technology. Egypt is in desperate straits in fighting ISIS in the Ikhwan and can use direct military help in the Sinai Desert. Even Jordan has been directly threatened by the Iranians. One big name is missing in all of this: America. Obama has sucked the air out of our alliances, and Putin is filling the vacuum. The power vacuum in the Middle East has been a loud sucking sound for a while now, and Putin kind of let it brew before he made his big move. Our own government is essentially shafting us too by blocking domestic oil production, for one example. The environmental movement has always helped the Arab oil producers by creating a phony psychology of oil scarcity, putting the Saudis in control of the world price of oil. As long as Obama is in power, things are likely to get worse for America. By sacrificing 60 years of Pax Americana, the left was taking a wild historic gamble. The left hates the American ideal and expects to benefit from Obama's dictatorial shenanigans. It's a paradox that Vladimir Putin, who saw the Soviet model crumble, is now allied with the last powerful church in the world, i.e. the Russian Orthodox Church, to become the rising new hegemon. America got infiltrated and suckered. The new powers will not be nice guys. All right. First off, the Russians have just concluded a deal, or are in the process of concluding a mega deal, with three of the Gulf states, Saudi Arabia, the Arab Emirates, and Kuwait, to sell them, and I think the total is around $30 billion worth of arms. Now, all of those outfits used to be major customers of the U.S. arms industry and the British arms industry and the French arms industry. Well, guess what? Russia is now their major source. Mm-hmm. Israel has made an accommodation with them. I believe I announced that last week, that military operations will be coordinated if the Israelis and the Russians are operating near the Israeli-Syrian border. They'll make sure there's no mistakes. In other words, military cooperation, which will then be followed by, as he mentions in the article, technological cooperation, etc., could be real close at hand. The other character in this that's only mentioned in passing is China. What you have not heard in all of this run-up to what the Russians did yesterday and today is that at the beginning of the week, several sources reported, and there were various pieces of this have been reported by these multiple sources, and I confirmed with the Camel Underground that, yeah, in fact, they were unaware of it until I brought it up, our source, and he took it to his sources, and they said, yeah, this just hit. The Chinese have sent warships to Syria. The first report was an aircraft carrier and a guided missile destroyer were spotted, Chinese were spotted heading north through the Suez Canal, which is the quickest way for the Chinese to get to Syria. Another report had it that a Chinese assault landing ship, i.e. the kind like what we carry Marines with and have helicopters and hovercraft, etc., was headed for Syria, was not apparently not part of the task force with the carrier and the destroyer. However, another report today said that they had landed 2,000 troops in Syria, the Chinese did, and I'm presuming that they landed them from that landing ship, because that's where the ground troops would have been positioned. Additionally, there's more rumblings about additional Chinese military assets that could be headed that way. Also, as reported at the beginning of the week by Bloomberg, which for some weird reason was not thrown into the mix when all this stuff was going on at the UN, and they were talking about the Chinese premier's speech, etc., at the UN this week. The Chinese have committed 7,000 troops, and I believe it was $1 billion, for UN peacekeeping operations, which could easily be morphed into what's going on in Syria. You've got Russian troops, Chinese troops. The Russians have been active in peacekeeping operations. In fact, I can show you some of their patches for the last several years. And the Chinese are now going to get into it. What a perfect opportunity for a UN peacekeeping operation then in Syria, with the Chinese and the Russians leading the way, commanded by a Russian general. We'll just have to see how that develops. But that could also be a convenient way of getting foreign troops to this country if there's some major domestic problem. Ferguson riots break out all over the country, etc., and Obama has to declare that we need foreign peacekeepers here. Russian and Chinese troops would be convenient for that because they have plenty of both. Well, a Russian general, and I've heard that he was a major general, and I've heard that he was a lieutenant general, so I don't know which it was, but yesterday he gave a letter to the U.S. Embassy in Baghdad, basically demanding, but they didn't use quite that wording. It was kind of a cross between a request and a demand that all NATO, i.e. U.S. primarily, but also the French, Jordanian, and other aircraft that have been launching air raids into Syria against ISIS, would cease operations immediately. And they, to make an exclamation point to that request, almost immediately there was a bombing raid by the Russian Air Force in Syria, which initial reports were that it was against ISIS, but now it looks like it was against some other rebel group that was against Assad. Some other group that's wanting Assad out of the picture was the ones that were actually hit, apparently. Again, that can't, I'm going to say that should not be confirmed yet. But there was a Russian air raid on somebody that Assad, that doesn't like Assad, whether it was ISIS or somebody else, doesn't really matter. This thing has got all of the earmarks of a very interesting time coming up. That whole thing got complicated with the Russian involvement. We knew it was going to when they announced they were going to go in and build or add on to an airbase, and it turns out more than one airbase. They have deployed air defense assets, i.e. surface-to-air missiles and air superiority fighter planes, which, why do they need those if they're going up against ISIS or some of the other anti-Assad groups in Syria? Because they don't have an air force. Who's got an air force over there? Those two assets are only needed to fight another air force. Now, ground attack fighter bombers, that's one thing. But air superiority fighters? And there's no telling what the Chinese are bringing to the mix. They will probably station their aircraft carrier off the coast and use it to support as needed Russian activity, or whatever they're going to call their little coalition that they're building, because it'll include Assad's Syrian government as part of their allied effort, I'm sure. Now, the Realpolitik has now entered the fray everywhere except in this country. Certain people like Trump have said vocally and quite vociferously and with exclamation points right and left and a little bit of emotion that what the heck is wrong with Russia over there fighting ISIS? Well, if they were fighting ISIS, but that may not be why they're there. Yeah. They claim that's why they're there.
It's to keep Assad.
But the main reason is to keep Assad in power. Now, this article, he mentions the history of Russia versus Islam. They've got an ongoing fight, which we were keeping close tabs on back in the early 90s, of the two Chechen wars. Chechnya is a province in the Caucasus that is semi-autonomous, i.e. they're kind of like a state here in the United States of America, in that they have their own governmental structure, their own police force, etc., and they're kind of a little bit independent. Well, the Chechens are Muslims predominantly. And they have gone to war twice now. We'll say they have gone to war twice now against the Russians in recent history in the 90s. First time was their activity started it when Boris Yeltsin was premier. And they were kind of beat. Or a draw, you might call it a draw, might be a better way to put it. And they signed a peace treaty, and everything went back to kind of the way it was, except that the Chechen leadership was then put in the hands of the Mujahideen, which is what they called themselves at the time. Well, Putin, when he took power, was given power by Yeltsin as interim prime minister, president, premier, whatever it was, he decided he didn't like the way that the first Chechen war turned out. And so he had the FSB, Federal Security Bureau, blow up two apartment complexes outside of Moscow and blame it on the Chechens. And of course, this came out that the FSB did it because they tried to do a third one and they got caught trying to blow up a third one. And it was linked back to the FSB. And everybody in Russia knows it. I've seen the documentary they did on it in Russia with English subtitles about that situation. It's quite an interesting, which we're not going to go into tonight, but basically it was a 9/11/01 all over again. They blamed the Mohammedans as an excuse for another war. And they went to war, and this time they kicked butt right off the bat. Putin deployed his most advanced non-nuclear weaponry, which happened to be the most powerful non-nuclear weaponry on the planet, i.e. fuel-air rockets. They have a fuel-air rocket that is fired exclusively by a full-track vehicle that will... Basically, one rocket will devastate a city block. And they leveled Grozny, Chechnya from the beginning. And it was a fairly quick war then. They basically used a sledgehammer when a fly swatter would have worked, which is the Russian way, okay? And the Chechens haven't forgotten it. That's why a bunch of them are fighting with ISIS and other... related type groups around the world. And we suspect that some of the people that have been spotted here that were blonde, blue-eyed Caucasians in some of the Mohammedan training camps fairly close to us are probably Chechens, imported from that part of the world to pass on information and training. Additionally, go back further in history to the Muslim conquests through the Ottoman Empire of Southwest Asia, which is now the Stan, Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, Kurdistan, or not Kurdistan. There's five of them in there that are on the borders with Afghanistan, Iraq, and Iran, and China. They are descended mostly from Genghis Khan's people, the steppe nomads, and they still have the nomadic way of life, but they owe a great deal of allegiance to the Russian Tsar because he kept the Muslims at bay. Yeah, initially they conquered the steppes where the stands are now, but... they were not able to institute the same brand of Mohammedanism because those people are very independent. They didn't live in villages. They lived on the go, following their herds of camels and goats and whatever else they were raising. Plus, they had the Mongol mindset, Mongol culture that Genghis Khan made famous. And I've seen those people at work, and they're a tough-looking bunch of folks. But the stands were infiltrated. They were settled with Turkmens and Slavs. So there's a racial mix in there. But the Slavs and some of the Turkmens are Russian Orthodox. The rest are Muslim. But they're not the same kind of Muslims as... the Afghans and Iraqis, Syrians, etc. They still owe allegiance to the Russians. The Russians have known how to deal with the Muslims for centuries, literally. The same way they dealt with the Chechens in the Second Chechen War is the way they like to deal with Mohammedans. they kill them all and let Allah sort them out. And Putin is going to use the same historical ideals that they've used in the past. For example, in Chechnya, in the Second Chechen War, he seriously ramped up and increased the power of the Cossacks. And you saw video of Cossack policemen in the villages of the Chechen Muslims. And the Cossacks and the Muslims have been hereditary enemies for, again, a few hundred years. The Tsars used the Cossacks as their stormtroopers for hundreds of years. And there was a hereditary hatred between them. Those people don't forget. The notion that the Hatfields and McCoy feud, people here think that was a big one. Now, that lasted, 20 years maybe? Their feuds over there last hundreds of years. So this is an interesting part of the world, and you're going to find it get even more interesting now, especially with the U.S. basically pulling out of there, which in some ways it's appropriate. Okay, I mean the neocons out there and the rhinos that are listening are going to be appalled by my saying this, but again, you've probably been appalled by a lot of what we said over the last few years. We don't have any use for neocons and rhinos. Fact of the matter is, George Washington's admonition of staying away from entangling alliances is even more appropriate for that part of the world. And he recognized that fact. He and Thomas Jefferson had to deal with these people along the North African coast, the Barbary pirates. But they dealt with them and had done with them and left them alone after that. After they took care of business, got the slaves back that the Barbary pirates had kidnapped, the ones they could find, they showed them, we got the power, we're going to use it. If you mess with us, don't mess with us. That's the difference between the guy in the White House now and previous history with the Mohammedans. They have to be shown that you're not going to mess with them. You're going to take care of business like the Russians have done. The only thing that these people understand is force. Don't kid yourself. I don't want to hear any platitudes, any do-gooder crap coming out of the politically correct out there. I don't want anybody who's politically correct even watching this show, because you're a lost cause. If you didn't fight against Planned Parenthood, if you're not still fighting against Planned Parenthood, you're a lost cause. So just turn the channel. You're not going to like much else of what we say here anyway. Reality does not enter into your game plan. You don't want reality. You want some made-up reality program, some fictional reality show that makes you feel good. Well, this is not feel-good reality. This is the real story, the real reality. And the real reality is that Obama has left a power vacuum that, again, Putin was just tickled pink to walk into. And he was a master of this one. He's a master at power politics. And it's like some of these people have said, including Trump, let them do it. Let them take care of these people. Okay? They have a lot of experience doing it. But in the meantime, the U.S. needs to, the U.S. government needs to just kind of get some decent advisors, and I don't mean neocons like the imbeciles that are on Fox, all of them. There's several good ones on there. Lou Dobbs needs to be one of them. The other one needs to be Ron Paul. Get some common sense into this thing. We're not the world's policemen. This is one thing that is really, it's typical though, this week. The neoconnery Fox people have have been beside themselves with the notion that, oh no, the U.S. is giving up its role as the world's policeman, as the bad boy, the bully of the world. Well, excuse the heck out of me, but Constitution doesn't say anything about that in here. Bill of Rights doesn't say anything about that in here. The Declaration of Independence says nothing about our being the bully of the world. We've got to have a realistic foreign policy, and certain people are right. Guys like Farrakhan are right in some cases, some of the stuff they talk about. Like, we brought a lot of this on ourselves. And the events immediately following and due to the 9/11/01 debacle are case in point. So you want to know what to do about this stuff? Take a look at what Putin does. Okay? Assad, once again, was the lesser of two evils. All of that so-called Arab Spring that occurred, 2 years ago now, was a sham, was a fraud to bring Muslim extremists into power, and Obama knew it. Obama is part of the problem in this thing. Oh. He's not part of the solution. That's big obvious. Part. So, you're going to find more and more of these countries over there, and European countries, siding with Russia against the wishes of America. Bottom line. These folks are not to be trifled with. And Putin knows how to deal with them.
Well, the biggest thing we have to do is keep our money here and not be sending it overseas.
Yeah.
I mean, bottom line, we don't owe those people anything.
No, actually, they owe us a lot.
A lot.
A lot.
We keep sending them money, Obama.
Or people. The word I got is that they're sending armor, heavy, they're sending tanks, not personnel carriers, not these mine-resistant vehicles. They're sending tanks to Kuwait. More is going to South Korea. And Iraq, even. They're sending armor to Iraq. Why? To counter the Russian armor in Syria? Excuse me? What kind of sense does that make?
What we are we left gonna do? A lot of armor.
Do what?
We left a lot of armor.
The tanks, they didn't have any need for the tanks. They pulled them out early in the Iraq attack. In Afghanistan, the Marines used a few, but only for knocking down walls and such, and fire support, infantry fire support, not what tanks are normally used for. Well, if they're beefing up our military over there in several places, some of the units that we've heard about don't know where they're going yet. They've just been alerted that they're headed out overseas, and they don't yet know where they're going. So it could be other places are going to get the assistance of the U.S. military, whether they need it or not. But is this all being done to counter what the Russians have done? Probably. A lot of it is. South Korea is an exception there. But that's not so much the Russians as the Chinese. What did we say, tell you about the Chinese? They had by several reports, more than one, that task force the Chinese sent to the Aleutians had some North Korean involvement. So it looks like the Chinese are cozying up to the North Koreans. The Russians are cozying up to the Syrians and the Chinese. And we're sending forces all over the world to counteract these things? Wait, what?
Don't really know.
Wait and see. Let's wait and see here. All right. Integrity Integrity?
Tom and I were talking earlier about some things, about things, and one of the words that came up was integrity. So before I came tonight, I Googled the word integrity. Y'all just sit in your chairs. Don't be standing up.
Well, this applies to all political events at all political levels.
Yeah, we have a couple with no integrity behind this article. But anyways, the full definition of integrity. Firm adherence to a code of especially moral or artistic values. An unimpaired condition. The quality or state of being complete or undivided. Now, we go to the second page, which is really where the fun is. There were actually four pages of this definition of integrity. Interesting. The synonyms for integrity are character, decency, goodness, honesty, morality. Sounds like we're discussing Congress.
Or not discussing Congress. We're fixing to discuss Congress when you get to the antonyms.
Oh, yeah. Probity, rectitude, righteousness, rightness, uprightness, virtue, and virtuousness. Now, the antonyms.
Congress and Hillary Clinton.
Yes, and many more. Badness, evil, evil doing, immorality, iniquity, sin, villainy, wickedness. And I'm sure there's a longer list.
The sin they don't have Hillary on there? Hillary, Bill and Hill. It should be Bill and Hill.
Bill
should
and
be
Hill.
An antonym of integrity.
Why do we bring this up? I'm going to give an example.
I got another one here.
Huh? Oh, yeah, the that one.
This one will make you sick.
I know, I read that one. I read that article. We have my good friend, Comrade Appel. Oh, I mean, Conrad Appel, who is the Senate Chairman.
Louisiana Senate now.
Louisiana Senate Chairman of Education. And his thing that he's handing out for re-election, his flyer, says a proven conservative. Wow. I must have been asleep in all those committee meetings.
Mm-hmm.
It says he led the effort to replace Common Core in Louisiana.
Well, there that's a lie. It's the exact opposite. He led the effort to keep it.
I'm going to read an article behind this. Ranked fourth most conservative member of the Senate. Phew. I didn't know I was dealing with such a good guy. Fought to preserve funding for higher education. Stood up for our Second Amendment rights. Named outstanding legislator by Louisiana Family Forum, of which they named about 50 of them. Now, this is the thing that people need to really start looking at, is who's funding these people? He is endorsed by SouthPac, LABE, Champions for Healthcare, Louisiana State Medical Society. Understand all these things. Louisiana Federation for Children. I don't know what the elephant thing is. The Voice of Small Business, and a real good one, Stand for Children.
All of those are Common Core. All the education-related organizations are Common Core
common
pushers.
Common Core.
Big time.
Now let's talk about the real Appel. We said this is a real show. Senator Appel's fight to keep Common Core initiative in Louisiana. My good friend Terry wrote this. Appel said, protecting the personal and private information of our students from third-party sharing implemented by Common Core would be problematic for government.
Well, of course. Anything that keeps government from watching out for us and watching over us is problematic for them.
You'll like this one. This is a man that really cares. This statement shows just how he cares. Appel told parents and other constituents in Metairie to stop calling him with complaints about the Common Core initiative. Oh, that's really being open-minded.
Wait, didn't he say he was against Common Core?
Yeah, he said led the effort to replace Common Core in Louisiana.
Well, he was going to replace it with something with a different name, but it was the same thing.
Well, they're rebranding it right now.
Yeah.
Appel was a sponsor of the Unicorns Are Not Real website, which ridiculed parents and teachers fighting for their children and opposing Common Core. There's that word, opposing. Appel, as Senate Education Committee Chairman, left the room during a presentation by Dr. Sandra Stotsky, who was on the Common Core Validation Committee and was speaking about the many problems and deficiencies of Common Core. Appel has blocked every bill attempting to stop Common Core in the Senate Ed Committee. And they give an example. Which I didn't go and print that out. I can tell you, after 3 years of constantly being in that committee room, he did everything he could. He wouldn't even bring bills to the table to run through the committee. And I can tell you that I had many challenging conversations with him. Also, last 2 years, when I went to the committee meetings, I sat in the front row, dead center of the room. Okay? More absurd comments from Appel. Appel made some suspicious Appel made some suspicious stock purchases on several occasions before and after Common Core decisions were made.
But the Ethics Commission doesn't think there's anything wrong with that.
Oh, no. Appel has been unwavering in his support for Common Core, his support for Superintendent John White, and his refusal to consider the pleas of parents. Perhaps the worst, John White's offense was releasing 700,000 student Social Security numbers to the unsecured third-party data collection vendor In Bloom. Guess that never bothered Appel either. This description fits him well. There are other things that I know about Appel, and Appel knows that I know about him. Mm-hmm. Now we're going to talk about a local. Well, should we do that now?
Yeah,
or
go
do
ahead.
You want to do that?
Go ahead and talk. We got.
Yeah. I'm going to catch it for this, but a thing was sent out in Vermilion Parish on Holly Bofi. I attended a thing 2 or 3 years ago, I can't remember when now, where she threw all of her friends under the bus. Why is that? I will front this with the fact that Holly Bofi has an education consulting business, which is, I have something to read back here somewhere, but anyways, which is tied to a lot of money that she's getting paid for, but not unethical. Her thing says she's a strong leader for education reform. If you ever sat in a meeting and watched Holly Bofi while the parents are talking, she don't care. She doesn't pay attention. She gets up and leaves the room half the time. She's texting. She might be texting John White because he's also texting at the same time. She says more students are graduating on time. How would they know that? More students are enrolling in college. They're all lies. ACT scores continue to climb. School dropout rate was cut nearly in half. There are no statistics. Nothing. You know who did this flyer for her? This is the good part. Not that they have any involvement, and they're funded by, what's that guy named, Gates?
Bill Gates.
Yeah, Bill Gates funds Stand for Children. They're the ones that made this flyer and sent it out.
I thought it was Stand on Children.
Well, yeah, it's Stand on Children. They get kind of upset to me when I say that to them. Holly says, Holly Vofey is a strong leader delivering substantial education reform. I can tell you right now, she voted against this thing they're doing right now. This education and looking over the standards, which all it is a rebrand. Under Holly's leadership and Vessi, great progress has been made, and Louisiana's education system has started to turn the corner.
What corner?
Yeah.
The one behind us.
Holly Vofey, fighting for accountability. That is such a crock. The Vessi board has no accountability. I could spend the next 30 minutes talking to you about the corruption that we've discovered in the last year by John White in there. And the Ethics Commission doesn't look at any of it. I also can tell you that I talked to the proper people to start an investigation into the Ethics Commission.
They need it.
Holly Vofey worked...
Wait, do they have any integrity either?
No.
Okay.
Holly Vofey worked to bring accountability to our schools. Holly fought to give local school districts the ability to retain and reward only the best teachers. Holly also helped establish a program called Jumpstart. Just go check out Jumpstart. That's all I got to say. You don't need to listen to me. Holly Vofey's greater investments in education. On Vessi, Holly put some more money into our schools and directly into the classroom. Well, directly into a lot of people's pockets. You know, I see stuff like this. That's why if I ran into her, I would talk to her about this. Integrity.
About what integrity is.
What integrity is. You know, here's a thing that one of our good people put out. Vofey equals Common Core. Vofey equals park testing. Vote no on Holly Vofey.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard in this case not to make a choice.
No, it's an easy choice, actually.
It's an easy choice because right here, how much time we got?
3 minutes and 40 seconds.
I have a list of the donations. And when you go through this list of donations, Tom would say, oh, that must be for those people. But what I want to get at, and we might discuss the other stuff afterwards, or in the next second hour, what did I do with it? There's a guy named Lane Grigsby. What did I do with it? Anyways, they have $750,000. $400,000 of that came from the Waltons in Walmart.
Mm-hmm.
Another $200,000 came from some guy in California.
His address looks like he's a Hollyweird. He lives on Hollyweird.
And I mean, it's amazing to me.
What is all this money pouring into the
why?
The Bessie race?
Question is why?
This is all going into the Bessie race. Races.
This money is being flooded into there. Holly had a thing out. I actually got it. I can't believe I got that email. But actually was wanting to hit $350,000 for her campaign. Y'all understand that Bessie is a non-paying job. They only get reimbursed for expenses.
Yeah.
But then Holly gets reimbursed by the CCSSO. And John White is also a director. But the Ethics Commission said that's not a bad thing.
Yeah, that's not a conflict.
Oh, here it is. Here, Tom and I were looking at this. The donations that came in. This is public record, by the way. All you got to do is go to the state. Lane Grigsby. Remember that name, Lane Grigsby. Wealthy guy. He owns...
He's in Baton Rouge.
Yeah, he owns Cajun Industries. And he is the chairman of Empower Louisiana Incorporated. Okay, and he is the chairperson. Doesn't have a treasurer. Interesting. What am I looking for here? Oh, yeah, here we go. This guy, Eli Broad. His address is 2121 Avenue of the Stars, Los Angeles, California. Hollywood. But why is he donating to a in Louisiana?
Yeah, but look at how much he's donated. $250,000.
$250,000. Also,
what's he going to get out of this?
I don't know. $100,000 from a guy named Respon Mission Hills, Baton Rouge.
We've got half a minute.
Got Al's the Waltons, $400,000. I mean, this is, we're going to talk more about this after the break, but this finance stuff, you people better wake up.
Yeah.
This is out of state money. Why? I know why.
Yeah.